Last year, she told us the story of her life. This year, she's about to take us on a journey with maps. Lesley Roy, hello.
Hi, Parik. How's it going?
Not too bad. I'm thrilled to be finally chatting to you after all this, all the madness that's happened the past 12 months or so. And we're chatting now a couple of days before you're all watching this interview. The song is not out yet. How are you feeling?
I am so excited. I can't wait for people to hear this song. And I feel like a lot of people kind of watched my journey, as well as obviously a lot of the other Eurovision artists, of the kind of work that's gone into writing and producing this song, which has been a lot. And it's you know, a lot within a pandemic to try and produce anything that's of, you know, high quality. So I'm really excited. I can't wait for Friday morning. I think this song is going to hit an even broader range of people. And I am like more, it's not even excited. I think I'm just more driven and passionate to get this out to the people than I even was this time last year.
So what's different about Lesley Roy in 2021 versus Lesley Roy at the same time in 2020?
Gosh, I mean, aside from not having access to the gym so much, emotionally, I think, you know, I think we've all, it's been a hard year, look, for everybody, right? So, again, like, kind of like how I just said, I think I was excited last year, and it was something I thought about as a songwriter that I would always like to do and maybe take it off the list. And I always knew Story of My Life was a great catchy song, and still know that that would have worked well in the Eurovision stage. But I think having gone through this whole year, connected with the likes of yourselves and like the really hardcore Eurovision fans all over the world, not just in Ireland, and really sitting down and writing so many songs to get to MAPS, I'm so like honored and ready to go with this song. And it just feels all seamless and exciting and hopeful. And I don't know, there's a very interesting buzz around this song and what the few people that have heard it are feeling as well. So not to hype it beyond extent, but there's a very passionate response to this song.
And do you consider it an evolution of Story of My Life, or is it a departure?
I think it leans more musically as a departure, because again, it's something I thought about a lot. As you can tell, I thought a lot about every single second of this new song, but I thought it would have been a disservice to everybody to go and write Story of My Life Part 2. Musically, because we already heard that, and I don't really like to do things that are very easy. I could have done 10 Story of My Lives, you know, but like that would have been a bit boring, and we would have been so obvious. So as much as it is still in keeping with positive pop that I always try and write about, it's sonically a departure. It's still an up-tempo, which you'll here on Friday. It's still an up tempo, and it still will hit people straight through their chest. So it's similar in a lot of feelings, but as far as sonically, and if it has that early 2000s feel, it does not have that.
And is it inspired by the pandemic at all?
Not so much on the nose as like we're sitting at home watching TV lyrics or anything like that. And a lot of that came up a lot, actually, Parik, in a lot of the sessions. You know, people are like, let's write the When We Get Back Together song, and when we're all one again. And again, I'm sure someone will write that lyric, and that'd be awesome. I found it a little bit of too much on the nose, and again, a bit of a disservice and obvious. So it's not necessarily straight down the middle inspired by the pandemic, But what this song is, it's a journey, metaphorically, like looking inward. So, and a lot of people have had to look inward because we've nowhere else to look within this pandemic. But so it is a looking inward to find your true self, or a self that may have been lost. And so in a way, a lot of people could relate to that within this last 12 months. And then it's also a little bit of a literal journey for me coming back home to Ireland and connecting with my roots.
And when you were, you made a big reveal that it was going to be called Maps. It was coming out on February the 26th. And you illustrated that with a picture on Instagram of you looking very solemn and thoughtful, staring into the distance in the mountains. There was the mist coming in.
Yeah.
It was almost Game of Thrones-esque. Is that aesthetic key to the message of the song? And how do they both link up together?
Yeah, well, the music video, I really can't wait for people to watch this video because, so Ash Brady was the director, and also then we also got a second director, Lockie McKenna, on top of it, kind of out of nowhere as well. So two amazing Irish directors, first of all, and I went to Ash with my idea, and I had the visual for the video as soon as we finished the song in Sweden, like straight away, and it's all about this search. And this looking and this kind of a dreamlike and a little bit dystopian future, kind of pandemic-y in a way, not so much on the nose, of being lost. And so there is a lot of out in the Wicklow Mountains, and there's some just amazing shots of me just literally searching. So the visual of the pictures that I've posted and the music video is the perfect marriage with the song. I think is the perfect marriage with the song.
And what was it like shooting the music video? Because the weather has not been ideal the last few weeks in Ireland.
Freezing! It was, knock on wood, I'm blessed that I'm not dying with a cold. It was so cold. And I thought I've been out in cold situations. But when we got up on that first day to that open space that you'll see, where there's really nothing covering you at all, and the crew, like small enough crew, but they all had like three coats on and like snow pants, and then I took my blanket off, and granted I have a long sleeve shirt on, but it was so cold. But it also, I'm glad it was a little hard to shoot, and the running for 2 days straight up and down the mountains, it was hard, but it kind of mirrors the past year, and it mirrored the uphill battle to get this song. So again, it would have been weird to do it in a studio and very glossy and gorgeous and somewhat Eurovision-y. It's not really in keeping with the glam bombshells of a Eurovision stage. It's very real and very honest.
Yeah, it sounds exhausting. I can't wait to see how it turned out. But
gotta get the B-roll, because I definitely did do one amazing fall all the way down a hill. So it's great.
Yeah, that's perfect content for the run up to the contest. Outtakes with Lesley Roy.
Oh, not a problem. Yeah.
And so what I'm going to do now is just rewind back to this whole process to, let's say, the 17th of May, 2020, the day after Shine a Light, when everything kind of came to a close, the end credits rolled, Eurovision 2020 was over. Where was your mind at that day, and where did you go from that point?
Yeah, God, I feel when you go straight to that, I mean, it seems like it's just been a very, like, much a snowball of work. I mean, I think up to that point, March, April, I had done the back and forth of, do I go and try and write another song? You know, lots of people loved Story My Life, but this has been kind of horrifying that it got cancelled. And there's also, you know, there was no guarantee that RT and I were going to agree on a song again. And it was just, I didn't necessarily know, but I think after Shine a Light, I don't know. I think just seeing the reaction, I knew I had to at least try to write a song. And I think I decided in and around that week that at the very least, if I can go and write something that I know I topped it, then I don't mind if they don't take it. Or if Michael, the head of delegation, has found something amazing, at least I'll know that I have balanced it out some kind of in the universe somehow. But as soon as I brought it back, he was fine with it straight away. But I did up into shine and like go back and forth on what to do.
And so then did you present a group of songs to RTE, or did you just have maps ready and were like, this is it, all or nothing?
Yeah, again, I kind of went back and forth on what the plan should be. And I wrote a lot of songs before I got maps. And I thought I would go in with maybe two or three. But then when I got maps, there was no point.
Yeah.
And I thought it would just confuse things and it wouldn't make sense. Because I'll be honest, I really went and I tried lots of different style. I tried a lot of different tempos. I tried a ballad. I tried something that would even teeter on being slightly humorous, because I wanted to make sure I went through everything that people wanted. And to get to, I was looking for what was true to me. And that is literally what the song became, is looking for something that's true to yourself, or, you know, something that you might have lost. I thought about bringing home a few songs, but maps just was such a front runner that it made no sense.
And we learned, the public, that you were going to be the artist for Ireland again in December. How long before that did you know that you were locked in for Rotterdam?
That was so hard. That was really hard, actually, because as you know from talking to the other artists, we got asked from March 18th all the way up until we got announced. So that was really a lot. But I understood RTE couldn't announce until that date. So I knew. Let me see. I wrote maps on September 24th. I knew I was gonna get home, and as soon as I quarantined, pitch it. So then it would have been October. Before, so I knew, and then I couldn't say.
So yeah,
that yell, yeah,
like a massive secret, basically.
Oh, and everyone asking and like still discussing, you know, Eurovision and what's going on. But that was a little bit more stressful.
Because I suppose this time the difference between this and last year was, last year you were unknown in the Eurovision circle. There wasn't expectations that you would be the artist, whereas I presume all summer you've probably had people in your inboxes bombarding you, when's the song, what's the story?
Exactly. Every single day since we talked about the George, I have done, called, messaged, recorded, chatted about the Eurovision. And that's great. And I am delighted that I get to be that person. But yeah, there was a lot of questions about, just release, are you the artist? Just us. I was like, I don't want to tell you, but I can't.
And that's one thing about you, compared to the whole other 40-odd artists, that you really make it a point to engage with the fans, and you're very active in replying to people on Twitter and Instagram. And you have a bit of fun with them. And even when people throw shade, you're able to throw a bit of sass back their way.
Yeah.
And do you find that when you were doing the whole creative process, was the fan reaction at the back of your mind, or did you put that to one side?
I think before I went into it, again, like I really did take note of what they said, maybe too much to an extent early on, like especially in and around my late show performance. But I had all of that stored of what worked, what I knew worked with Story of My Life. And I did take a lot of that in with me, you know, and a lot of the kind of harsh comments about it being dated and stuff like that. And some of that was really helpful. And I think, you know, I'd have to be a really obnoxious artist or songwriter to think I know every single thing about writing a song. So in my 17 odd years of writing with every single, the biggest pop producers of the world, plus being like, you know, open enough to listen to what Joe Soap in the middle of nowhere says about my song, I feel like I have more of a leg up on everyone else if I put the two of those together versus just not listening to anybody. Because at the same, like, it's not just an album I'm releasing for me, that Lesley Roy, I am representing a country at the end of it all. So I'd be very foolish not to listen to everybody.
And that probably put you under a bit of pressure, that you had so many people, you had the Irish head of delegation, you had RTE, you had all the fans, whereas Story of My Life was probably something that you put it in the hope that it would be picked. And yeah. if it wasn't picked, it wouldn't be the end of the world. Whereas now you were kind of like locked in and you had the pressure that you had to match it or beat it.
Totally. So that's like back to, you know, either I'd go for it or I'd just say, I'll walk away. So I think once I knew I'd go for it, I think I took a bit of the pressure with me to a lot of the sessions, and that some days worked and then some days worked against me where I just nothing was happening. But I myself as an artist and a person do work a little bit better under a bit of pressure. So I think at the end of it all, it did help me knowing how much I wanted to write something great for everybody and for the people that didn't even get Story in My Life. I wanted them to understand what this means to me to represent Ireland.
And people who followed you closely, like all through the summer, will have seen all your updates with different sessions with different writers. So there's clearly a decent amount of songs that were left behind on the cutting room floor. Will they ever see the light of day?
Potentially, if I can, I think after the fact and after I can remove myself a little bit from maps, because I'm so far into it right now, I can see if there's the four or five that make sense sonically together, because like I said, I tried a lot of different things, so I don't think all 15 of those songs would make sense together. So I think there could be some songs that weave together into an EP, and that would be so much fun.
Well, we'll all be like first in line to pre-save it on Spotify and have a listen. So depending on when people are watching this interview, you'll have either be about to or have done your Late Late Show live performance.
Yes.
And I presume that we won't be seeing any of your staging, that it will be something completely different.
Yeah, completely different. It's actually, though, as far as Late Late Show performances, though, this is going to be an epic performance. Not a regular Late Late Show performance. So I'm very, very excited about that in it of itself. But I'm also very excited about our Rotterdam performance, because I'll give Wiwi the exclusive on this one, is that our creative director this year is Fredrik Rydman Benka, who did the staging and the creative directing for Måns Zelmerlöw Heroes.
Oh, wow.
So we have a winner on the team, and Benka is his nickname. We've been working together now on this concept since December. So yeah, that's the exclusive for you guys. And I really just hope we get to go there.
And have you done your live track pre-record yet, or have you it scheduled?
Yeah, the dress rehearsal for that is tomorrow. Okay. And it's on, then the block of time that we shoot it live is on Thursday, and then we roll right into the Late Late on Friday.
So it's no rest. It's like music video, interviews, song recording, and then what will you do on Friday?
Leave. I will sleep on Saturday, or probably not. I'll probably be chatting to you all online, because it's great. Like this is why artists like myself, I hope, went so hard to write another song, is because you guys love it, and that makes me love it even more. So,
and are you prepared for the possibility that you might not get to be on the Rotterdam stage?
Yeah, I mean, I think after last year, and just when you go through. Anyone going through any version of life this year has to know, if you're getting into something, you have to be very aware that it could just be gone the next day. So I did get into it knowing that. And that was another reason that I wanted to push really hard and make a very epic music video. And, you know, we'll do our best with the backup tape. Obviously, I wish we'd have more time and more similarities to what Benka and I would like to do for Rotterdam. But at the same time, what Alan Byrne, the director, is doing in RTE, as far as a backup tape of what we can do there, I think it will be what it is if yeah. it gets canned. And I will, you know, happily take down my Irish representative hat and leave it as that for Eurovision.
Well, I think everybody will be like crossing their fingers and saying a few Hail Marys and everything that you'll get to go in Rotterdam. And even if it means sacrificing an audience, it would be just great to see it come out on stage. Because you have been making a big effort to work within the regulations and the restrictions, that you've even moved your life over from New York back to Ireland. And how has that been?
It's been great. And you, I mean, no move in the pandemic is like fantastic. But as far as it's been nice. And again, not to sound so hyper focused on the song, this has been a bit of a reconnecting to Ireland for me this whole year. And the song is quite symbolic of that. So it's been nice being home in Balbriggan. And we've like outside of that, adopted my grandmother, and she's living with us, and she's going to be living with us indefinitely. So, you know, it's at this point, if I could get an Irish flag tattooed on my head, I might as well, because I can't really represent us any more than that. So it's been great. It feels right to be here for this. And again, like even more seamless, even though it's harder, even more seamless than last year.
Mm. And I noticed on a lot of your stories in from Dublin and places that you're tagging the Irish Music Institute. And what's their involvement with the song?
So they have set up, oh my God, this is just an amazing unit in Balbriggan that they've created. And they're still building on it. So it's this Irish Institute of Music and Song, and they've just started to get going, and they're around the corner from my apartment. So they had, you know, contacted me when Eurovision was happening last year, and if I would do some interviews and podcasts, and we got talking, and I finally got home to see it. And it's this whole center of what they will build into music lessons and song lessons and workshops for people all over the world coming and living there, staying there for a few weeks and writing and recording and learning instruments and learning about the Irish Music Center, music like industry past and present. And those guys just said, you know, we've got all these writing rooms because they're open right now with the pandemic. So I've been rehearsing in there, and they've been a massive support to Team Ireland, and amazing catch. You guys catch everything.
And you catch everything too, because people notice that you'd be like trawling on Instagram and you'd see random things. How closely have you been keeping an eye on what's going on in the UK and Sweden and all the other countries? Have you been following any of the selections or any of the songs that have been selected so far?
Yeah, I'm not listening to any of the songs this year. I know what's happening with the artists. Like, I know James coming back, and I know Melfest is on, because I know a lot of my friends are the writers. Here I had a very firm decision that I'm not listening to any of the songs. Just because I'm so into maps, and I'm so into our direction. And I don't have time to get too wrapped up in that this year.
Yeah. Probably best to have a clear focus and not get in your head.
I think I was too much of a fan last year, watching it and looking at the bookies and the bets. And it's much more fun this way.
Yeah. Like, in a way, it's given you a second chance to kind of do everything. And you've learned from your last year's experience, and you're coming in sort of as a veteran, isn't the right word, but if you know that kind of, that sense. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, I thought it would have been such a missed opportunity to have seen where I went wrong to not come back and try and do it. Like, it would have been a complete, you know, waste of time. So yeah, I feel like I learned so much last year, and I hope that's very apparent in everything this year.
And now, William did an interview with you last year where he kind of talked about the story of your life, so to speak, before Eurovision, because you've had a fascinating career. You've worked with Max Martin, you've written songs for WWE, you've written for like lots of famous singers, and you had a big album in the States back about 10 years ago or a little further. So if people want to watch that, the link, we'll leave the link in the description. But my question then is, do you hope now that you can use maps to capitalize and sort of reestablish yourself in Ireland and in the Irish market? I know you did it a little bit with Golden after Story of My Life, but do you hope to capitalize on that and maybe become a bit more active on the Irish scene?
Yeah, and I mean, I think, like, being completely honest, that was one of the reasons coming back home, and coming back home with such a huge career from the States, you know, and thinking that, okay, well, the quickest way kind of back in the door as a songwriter would be to come in and really knock the Eurovision out of the park as the Irish artist and songwriter. So yeah, that was always in the back of my mind. But I think I've just, like, that has become such the obvious picture now, and that's why we moved here. And that is definitely what I'm trying to do. And I hope that I can use this platform to do that, because, again, it's been great being back home, and the music industry has changed a lot here in comparison to when I left to really try and seek out getting on radio. And I think it's been said a lot this year about women, Irish artists, female artists on the radio. Like, it's been in the press a lot. And, you know, I left for one of those reasons, because it was very hard to get the promo here. So, yeah, I think if I can really, like, you know, come back here and create that splash already on top of what we've done with Story My Life, then 100% that is part of the plan.
Yeah, because that was one of the sad things about last year. Story of My Life was trending on YouTube and it got into the homegrown charts, and the next thing, Eurovision was cancelled, and it kind of brought the momentum, not necessarily within the Eurovision community, but within the wider Irish public. It kind of brought it to a halt, that people were kind of like, Eurovision is over.
It did. And what was kind of also shocking, but not shocking, because, like I said, the male-female aspect is how, like, when I landed here and, you know, the Icelandic song was on the radio, but our song. So I, you know, unfortunately, we still feel the difference. And I think that's another big thing that I'm going to try and promote this year, is how important it really is. Take me aside, moving forward, how important it is for the country to get behind the artist and the song and support it. And there's no easier, nicer way of saying it, because it really help, you know. It would be like sending our football team off and being just booing them all the way, or saying they don't deserve funding, they shouldn't go, we should just cancel because they haven't won in 10 years. So I really want to try and promote us promoting our artists, you know, great for this year, but from here on out, the way we used to.
Because that's one of the things, as an Irish artist, you kind of have an extra hurdle to get over, that the Irish mentality towards Eurovision. And the thing is, when you strip Eurovision away, they like the songs, because Duncan Lawrence is in the top 30 now after 2 years, and Daddy got into the charts too. But, like, that's one thing. And do you think MAPS has the capability to potentially change minds about how people view Eurovision?
I hope so. I really hope so. I will have to take a very hard, long, hard break if people are confused by this. I'm totally joking. I really hope it does change people's minds. I was very aware of how to try and make something even more broad and hit a 7-year-old and a 70-year-old, but still make it honest. Like, not just tick boxes like, oh, it's at X tempo and it's at this key, even though I did still do that. But I just, I hope it changes people's minds, because that's been a thing that has pushed me all the way through all of this, is to get up to a place that I know we deserve to be. But I really feel like there's only so much, well, for me, there's only so much I can do after this year. I really would love the support of the Irish community behind this, outside of our great Irish fandom, like the other people that love Eurovision, to get behind this and stop being so, oh, wasn't it great in the old days? Because it was great in the old days. It was brilliant, but it's also great now.
Yeah. Well, I know that you're a very busy woman, so I'm going to let you go. And I'm going to have my fingers crossed. And I don't have a pair of rosary beads, but if I did, I'd be clutching them and counting down the hours till the song comes out. And before I let you go, because you have a lot of them, I'm going to ask, do you have a message to give to all your fans?
Whew. I mean, on the broad scheme of things, just for people to try and stay positive and stay safe. And then on the smaller Eurovision scale, that I hope I see everybody in Rotterdam.
Yeah. Thank you, Lesley. It's been wonderful talking to you. And hopefully someone at Wiwibloggs will get the chance to talk to you again later on in the season. Yes. And everybody watching, just give this a like and subscribe, and there'll be reaction videos to Lesley and everything else this Eurovision season coming up. So until next time, bye.